I'll be speaking a bit about autism and eating disorders as they overlap, whether you take it from the point of view of autism on the one hand or from the eating disorders point of view on the other, in particularly girls and women, but also to some extent in boys and men. Now, we discussed this at length this morning, and I would just like you to remember that the essence concept does not mean that there is like one of the disorders is more important than the other. It just means that it's an umbrella term for somebody reminded me that actually this is taking us all the way back to the 1970s when MBD or minimal brain dysfunction was all the craze and everybody wanted to get rid of it because it was sort of an etiological diagnosis when in fact we didn't know that it had anything to do with minimal brain dysfunction. But the old concept of MBD, minimal brain dysfunction, is actually not that dissimilar from the concept of essence. Because minimal brain dysfunction in the 1960s and 70s was a concept that encompassed all the children with various kinds of what we now refer to as neurodevelopmental disorders. The problem with it was that people surmised that it was due to minimal brain dysfunction, and there was actually no good evidence that there was anything minimal about it. But it wasn't reasonable to call it maximal brain dysfunction. But some people at the time called it maximal brain confusion, MBC, and that's to an extent where we're at today. So we're full circle back to thinking about the need to sort of slice up all the disorders into little boxes, and then getting back to maybe we don't know that they do fit exactly these boxes. And when it comes to eating disorders, it's clearly the case that for a long, long time, it's been very similar to the development of autism when it comes to specific service development, at least in the United Kingdom and in some other countries as well. There have been developed eating disorders units, and they're so specialized in eating disorders that they don't see anything other than the eating disorder. And sometimes that's almost a good thing if you are the right kind of patient. But if you're the kind of patient who doesn't only have an eating disorder, it becomes a problem. So I won't go into this, but this slide that I showed you this morning from the Emmanuel Miller lecture in 1991, that's 26 years ago, it already showed, you see the oval bit there with anorexia in it. Anorexia nervosa clearly overlaps with many of the essence type disorders. So I also showed you this, but I'll linger a little bit longer here on the bottom bit of it, where you can see that very often the first or at least one of the first major problems in children who later get a diagnosis of autism is something to do with feeding. In the newest study we've done on early symptoms in autism, insistence on sameness is actually there in the vast majority of clear classic autism cases, even at the age of 10 to 12 months, and it's very often around food. So insisting on eating only one type of food, insisting on eating only when seated in a special chair or in a special position, or using a special equipment, or having a special puzzle on the table, jigsaw puzzle, that's actually something that's very often a sign that this child is perhaps in the autism spectrum rather than your typically developing child, whatever that is. I mean, I took issue with the concept of normality. I also have problem with typical development. If you go to research, you will find all these studies published on children with autism and typical and or neurotypical. Who knows what a neurotypical person is? I haven't seen any publication that's actually dealt with the problem of calling anybody typical. But nevertheless, people use it all the time, and I've done it too. But I don't think it's... we have to rethink the whole typicality issue. But anyway, food fads and or feeding problems are very, very common in early autism, and perhaps particularly common in early autism in girls. And so girls who present at a very early age with very severe eating problems, people should think long and hard about whether or not it's autism or an eating disorder or both. And there's now a new concept that's in this slide, which is called ARFID, which I'll come back to. But it's abnormal restrictive intake of food. The typical problem is one of refusing to eat a number of foods, perhaps even almost all foods, and, you know, shutting your mouth, not opening it, and after the breastfeeding period is over, some of these, both boys, but particularly girls, will just not open their mouth to have any food at all, or refuse any food that has any particular sort of consistency or any particular flavor, and the child may look like this, as though it smells bad or something like that. I'll come back to this in a little while. But the connection between early unusual feeding behavior and autism is one which I think people will need to think about. When parents approach you, for instance, at child health centers complaining about their children's not eating, you probably should take it a little bit more seriously than in the past, when we, I think all of us, were trained to sort of calm people down, to always say, no, it's nothing, every child has a period like this. And of course, when it comes to things like feeding and sleep, most children have something of a problem for a brief period of time, or for recurring but brief periods of time, but not, you know, month after month after month after month. It doesn't go on forever, and you'll find ways out of it. But when children insist on very strange eating behaviors, and parents go along with it because they realize that if I don't, we'll have all hell, that's when you should start thinking about, maybe this is more than just a normal feeding problem. So ARFID, or Avoidant Restrictive Food Intake Disorder, was introduced in the DSM-5 as a special diagnosis. It wasn't there in the past, but most people who have worked in the field of development or in the field of eating disorders have been aware that there's always been a group of particularly young girls who from a very young age had this extremely restrictive and avoidant behavior in relation to food. And the diagnostic criteria for ARFID, according to the DSM-5, are an eating or feeding disturbance, such as a apparent lack of interest in eating or food, avoidance, particularly based on sensory characteristics of the food, or concern about aversive consequences of eating. This is for the slightly older child. When you get to 8, 9, 10-year-old children, then very often that comes into the picture as well. This might be dangerous food. I don't know if it's ecological, that sort of thing. So it can be even more sort of, in that sense, specific, that you can hear the child complaining about aspects of toxicity or whatever. But in the very young child, it's virtually always the apparent lack of interest, or, you know, just not opening your mouth, and if the consistency of the food seems to be not appropriate for the child. But it should then be also, in order to make the diagnosis, associated with one at least of the following. So the child has lost significant weight, or it's clearly the case that this child is nutritionally deficient for whatever reason, or even admitted to hospital for parenteral or enteral feeding, more generally, that the child doesn't function at all because of this strange feeding and eating behavior, even at the age of 1, 2, 3. In the day nursery, for instance, he or she will not eat with the other kids. It's they absolutely refuse to have anything to do with food and avoid it at all times and all cost. And for the diagnosis to be made, it should not be explained by the lack, of course, of available food or of a culturally approved practice. And it does not exclude, it doesn't appear exclusively in the presence of anorexia nervosa or bulimia nervosa. And also it states that it should not be better explained by another mental disorder or medical condition. That is, I think, a problem because, again, in the field of autism, as I've already mentioned, ARFID is probably quite common. And we should not say, as we did in the past, that autism, for instance, or eating disorder cannot be diagnosed in the presence of other things. I think it makes the point clearly, and it is a good point, that you shouldn't both make the diagnosis of ARFID and anorexia nervosa, but you could definitely make the diagnosis of ARFID in cases of autism and vice versa. So, as I mentioned this morning, it is very likely, and indeed there is some, but not a lot, of evidence scientifically that adolescent and adult females and some males who have had autism and or another disorder problem constellation subsumed under the ESSENCE umbrella all their lives are often misdiagnosed as suffering from usually only one of the following: depression, perhaps the most commonly overdiagnosed condition in girls of 12 to 18 years of age with autism, eating disorder, as we've come back to, anxiety. We've heard a lot about how this is the most common disorder in autism. I still take issue with that. I don't think it usually is a separate disorder. I think it's a different type of anxiety that comes from the catastrophic reaction to overstimulation or not understanding what's going on in the environment. And as long as the environment is more predictable, the anxiety comes down to a very different level. And it's usually not disorder in the same sense that when you diagnose anxiety disorder, as it were, in other people. There's definitely a lot of anxiety about in autism, but I think it's perhaps not appropriate to call it anxiety disorder. And in the field of ADHD, we've done a number of studies to show that anxiety disorder is very often something that people mistake ADHD for anxiety disorder and vice versa. So the symptoms that we refer to, as I mentioned this morning, as anxiety is very often symptoms of overactivity in the autonomic system, overactivity in the motor system, inability to calm down, inability to, as it were, cool off, being tense and high-strung. These are very typical symptoms of ADHD, but of course what people sort of conceive of as anxiety. And if you ask a person with ADHD about anxiety, he or she will almost definitely either say, I can't calm down. I can never be completely at rest. That's one of the major problems in my whole life. And an adult psychiatrist would definitely think about that as anxiety. And we've seen in a number of studies, if you treat that kind of problem with a stimulant, for instance, or with other measures to counter the effects, negative effects of ADHD, that kind of anxiety is no longer perceived of as anxiety. Social problems and family problems, and in a big study we did many years ago that we're now following up on, 100 girls with social and attention deficits that are now adults, they were kids when we first saw them. The most common diagnosis that they had in their records was family relationship problems. And not even a word of mention about the fact that this girl had autism all her life or ADHD, and very often the combination of the two. And borderline, I mentioned this morning also, or other personality disorder. If you follow people with autism and ADHD and other ESSENCE up until their 30s and 40s, you'll find a lot of them have been diagnosed or have symptoms that people would categorize as chronic fatigue or chronic pain syndrome. And Gary McFarlane, an epidemiologist in the UK, has shown in a very large study that the strongest predictor of chronic fatigue and chronic pain at the age of 40 in women is the presence of ADHD-type symptoms in late school times, around 14 to 16 years of age. It strongly predicts the presence of chronic fatigue and chronic pain 25 years later in women. And also I mentioned that they very often have become involved with social services.